what is known as the rule of law, which is the essential ingredient of development. Without rule of law, there is no development, and without development, there is no progress, and there is no peace. This is the reason for our work. As US citizens that come from both shores of the Caribbean basin, we would like our hemisphere to be a beacon of light in a world where the negative impacts of globalization seem to have taken hold. Every day we read in the press that crime, international organized crime runs rampant. We also learn about drug trafficking and also that money laundering and terrorist finance that targets our financial system. And arms trade furnishes weapons to terrorist organizations everywhere. The Americas, however, have so far made important progress in the execution of the international framework to fight these scourges, as well as the application of the principles of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And we would like this progress to continue, but this can only happen if we address the corrosive effects of the so-called 21st century socialism over democratic institutions. Nations promoting this political system have silently spread the seeds of trouble in the yet fragile democracies of Latin America. They aim at subsuming all institutions to the will of a caudillo. Achieving this goal demands to place all powers under the command of the executive, which is completely different as separation of powers. It's the opposite road. Alexis de Tocqueville warned the world about the dangers of socialism, particularly when it wears the robes of democracy. And I quote, "Democracy and socialism have nothing in common but one word, equality. But notice the difference. While democracy seeks equality in liberty, socialism seeks equality in restraint and servitude." End of the quote. President Correa of Ecuador clearly underlined the vision of the 21st century socialism when he indicated, and I quote, "The President of the Republic, listen to me and listen very well, is not only the head of the executive branch, he's the head of the entire Ecuadorian branch of the Ecuadorian state. It is the executive branch, the legislative branch, the judicial branch, the electoral branch, the transparency and social control branch, the offices of the superintendents, the attorney general, the controller. That is the Ecuadorian state." So we must all agree that this vision would have been enthusiastically supported by world-known authoritarians from Genghis Khan to Adolf Hitler. This is precisely what makes the practice of slowly corroding the judiciary so dangerous for our democracies. In a world marked by profound transformation, the only road to progress is inclusion. But for people to be included, they need to be respected as human beings, as citizens, as toilers of a common land. In order for this to happen, they have to be equal in front of the law, and their rights need to be guaranteed. The Inter-American Institute for Democracy and the Inter-American Bar Association aim at contributing to this end by means of conducting research that leads to a strengthening of the rule of law, which starts with the separation of powers, because this is the best way to protect freedom and to seal in development. Development is no longer a choice in our hemisphere, but it's a necessity. So, because we need the US, which is the engine of growth, to restructure its economy, counting on Latin America as its trading partner and as a generator of inputs for a relaunched manufacturing sector that creates meaningful jobs. These interactions, which are essential to break the cycle of economic decay and democratic disillusion in the Americas, have to rest in an everyday stronger rule of law. Economic institutions are critical for determining whether a country is poor or prosperous, but it is politics and political institutions that determine what economic institutions a country has. In addressing the Andean Corporation for Development annual conference, Vice President Biden recently indicated, and I quote, "No democracy can be sustained without economic growth, And economic growth cannot flourish in the absence of rule of law. It's sort of the new physics of economic relationships. Businesses do not invest in nations where the rules are not transparent and predictable, where the court system is not fair, where intellectual property is not protected. At the Inter-American Institute for Democracy and the Inter-American Bar Association, we are doing our part in fighting for democratic freedom. We trust that you will do yours. Thank you so much for being with us today. So now, we are going to continue this program by giving the floor to Dr. Bjorn Arp. Dr. Arp is the president of the Inter-American Bar Association. He's a fellow of the American University Washington College of Law Center on International Commercial Arbitration, where he also co-teaches International Commercial Arbitration. He's also editor-in-chief of the Law of the Sea Reports, and he's a partner at Aparicio Arp and Associates LLC in Washington.
Thank you very much. The Inter-American Institute for Democracy for the invitation, in particular Ms. Beatrice Rangel. I also want to thank the coordinator of the book, James Keeble, for all his efforts to make possible this event here. The Inter-American Bar Association has co-sponsored the research and publication of the book that we are commenting on today. However, I'm not the Secretary General, the President of the Inter-American Bar Association, but the Secretary General of the Inter-American Bar Association has had difficulties of being here today because she already had an event outside of Washington that obligated her to travel. So I'm representing her as a member of the DC chapter of the Inter-American Bar Association. So this book compiles six case studies on human rights violations in Ecuador that have one common denominator, which is the violation of human rights through the activity of the judiciary in Ecuador. At first sight, this topic may seem contradictory in its own terms. Because traditionally, in Latin America, human rights violations were committed by the governments through the police forces or the military or other government agencies. The victims of these abuses, when sometimes tried and even sometimes even successfully, presented their cases to the judiciaries of these Latin American countries. However, often when the human rights violations were motivated by political animosities, the governments prevented these people from actually accessing the judiciaries of these countries. In those cases, these people had access or recourse to international human rights mechanisms. However, I would argue that there has started to be a new generation of human rights violations in the hemisphere. And this is precisely what the study, this book, tries to convey. And these human rights violations take place through within the judicial apparatus of the Latin American countries. In these situations, the governments or the public authorities that want to harm a person, that somehow want to restrict the rights of a person, they create just any kind of judicial action against that person. And once the judiciary takes on that case and starts to follow their proceedings, or a large variety of human rights violations take place that ultimately can destroy the lives or the dignities of these victims. This way, the courts of justice have become the new accomplices of ruthless rulers and of corrupt public authorities. Now, these human rights violations through the judiciary can take a large variety of forms. From my own experience, I can mention a few types of violations that may be observed. For instance, there are many situations where there is a lack of a balanced or reasoned evaluation of the evidence. We can find situations where the prosecution is able to submit more than 100, maybe 180 witnesses in a criminal case, while the defense only is allowed to submit 4 or 5 witnesses. And these imbalances certainly can create difficulties in making or defending their case. But also in criminal investigations, there are many other situations where the imbalance can be felt and can be realized through the action of through the interaction of the play between the prosecutor and the judge under political pressure from the governments. Another type of violation may be the extension ad aeternum, the extension over a very long period of time of the judicial proceeding, which then ultimately also can hamper the rights of the persons. Another practice very common in Latin America is the forced removal of judges that do not seem to be negatively predisposed against the victim. As soon as the prosecutor, as soon as the government realizes that, the judge is separated from the case and other judges are put into its place. This leads to a very widespread practice in Latin America of the provisionality of the judges. The judges any longer do not really hold their office of the bench, but they are provisionally put into place strategically through government decisions. And finally, another example that I want to highlight is the very frequent use of the so-called provisional measures or cautelar measures in Latin America, which already kick in the moment of the criminal investigation. And they can lead to the situation where the victim's assets are annotated, are embargoed by the state. And this then leads to situations where the victim is not any longer able to pay the legal representation of its choice, and this way very starkly hampering any chances of reasonable defense of the victim. Overall, all these different human rights violations are much more sophisticated than the measures taken by previous generations of autocratic leaders, where victims were simply kidnapped, often tortured, and summarily executed. Mm. However, the result is very similar, because people that suffer from oppressive justice systems are excluded from the society and from the political democratic process. They cannot take part into that anymore in any efficient, meaningful way. In addition, in some countries, like Ecuador, I think is a good example, the weak parliamentary structures and the very broad powers of the presidency lead to situations where laws are adopted that create additional quasi-judicial proceedings that are in addition to the ordinary justice. Like, for instance, the 2013 communications law that created specific procedures to deal with cases of libel and slander against public authorities, and that have contributed strongly to violations of freedom of expression in this country. Now, most victims today have very broad powers or very broad rights to submit their cases to international human rights mechanisms. Just focusing on Ecuador, we can see that victims have a very broad range of institutions to which they can submit their cases. Within the United Nations, I may just mention the Human Rights Committee, that supervises the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, but there are also many other committees, specific organs created within the structure of the United Nations that supervise the implementation of the United Nations human rights treaties. And Ecuador is party to most of them, if not all. In regard to the Inter-American human rights system, I may also mention the fact that also there, the victims can submit their cases to the Inter-American Commission of Human Rights, and if all the means at the availability of the commission are exhausted, the commission may decide also to submit the case to the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. All these international human rights mechanisms have the advantage of being able to declare the international responsibility of the state for human rights violations. And not only that, they can also decide about the reparation that the states have to grant to the victims for these violations. These reparations may be the payment of compensation, but also in the practice of these mechanisms, we can see other measures, specific measures that they have ordered the states to adopt to repair the harm done to the victims. One that comes to my mind is that they can order the reinstatement of judges that have been forcefully removed from office because of their judicial decision line counter to the interests of the government. And in addition, what I also would like to underline here is that maybe one of the biggest contributions of these international human rights mechanisms is that they publicly recognize the wrong committed to the individual, with which the individual is reivindicated in regard to the state, and eventually, after a regime change, can also use this as a way to obtain reparation within the judicial system of the state. However, regardless of all these legal and symbolic importance of the international human rights mechanisms, there are also some characteristics, some factors that reduce the efficiency of these mechanisms in an ideal scenario, and that victims also have to keep very well in mind when they address these mechanisms. I may identify very briefly four of these factors that I would that I can observe. The first one is that these international mechanisms are composed of individuals that themselves have been nominated or proposed by the member states of the system. So we are in facing an intergovernmental scenario where the members of the same institutions that deal with human rights cases in regard to the system's member states are themselves coming from the same member states. So this can lead to situations where where the same representatives are in line with their own states or with their allied states. And this has led to a certain reduction in efficiency in certain cases of the international human rights mechanisms. The second factor that I would like to highlight is that also the NGOs have more and more permeated the international human rights mechanisms. And they increasingly have their own agenda, which does not necessarily coincide with the claims, with the individual claims of the actual victims of the human rights. And this, in a long-term perspective, may also lead to a certain reduction of the actual efficiency or interest for the victims of these mechanisms. As a third factor, I would like to state also the problem of the financing. The financing, as the staffing, comes from the member states. So also the member states, particularly in weaker structures like it happens in the inter-American system, the states try to reduce the financial contributions when they see that the mechanism is taking decisions against their own interests. As a fourth factor, maybe the most well-known factor, is the fact that these international human rights mechanisms do not have an enforcement mechanisms by which they can obligate, by which they can really enforce the decisions once they have adopted some resolution or some ruling on a human rights situation. The mechanisms still today depend on the voluntary and spontaneous compliance by the states of these decisions. And that also, in some cases, however not in all, but in some cases, it can lead to difficulties in the implementation of these mechanisms. So the victims certainly feel the consequences of these shortcomings, and they have to keep those in mind when they address these mechanisms. For the purpose of this book, however, I think that they clearly demonstrate that any change in the judicial system, which is ultimately what advocates this book, the changes need to come within Ecuador. The international mechanisms can help, they can create guidelines, they can give ideas, suggestions of how to actually have a judicial system that fully complies with international human rights standards. However, the input, the energy, the actual movement of change has to come from within the societies affected. In particular, here we're talking obviously about Ecuador. In this sense, the book here, which we are commenting on today, is a first attempt at showing the problems of the judicial system and to formulate some of the solutions that may be implemented in that country. I hope that it raises sufficient awareness about the risk of the usurpation of the courts of justice by the government, and I encourage really the authors as well as everybody here in this room to continue denunciating internationally the judicially made human rights violations. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, we are now very lucky to have among ourselves one of the most distinguished persons in the field of human rights, Dr. Cassel. Dr. Cassel is not only one of the builders of the international human rights system, but he's also a warrior that has not hesitated to put all the weight of his of the respect that the world has for him to fight the causes of victims of human rights everywhere in the world. Dr. Cassel is also a distinguished and widely published scholar, attorney, and commentator specializing in international human rights law, especially in regarding the issues of business and human rights, regional human rights system, international criminal and humanitarian law. He's the president of the board of the Justice Studies Centers of the Americas, in which he has been, to which he has been elected 3 times by the Organization of American States, and is the former president of the Due Process of Law Foundation. He's going to address as a keynote speaker in this seminar, and we are so happy to have him here. Let's welcome him with a warm applause.
Thank you very much, Beatrice. I'm going to ask that you accompany me to all my future. I'm going to ask you that you accompany me to all my future presentations to give that wonderful novelistic introduction. I want to congratulate the Inter-American Institute for Democracy, the Inter-American Bar Association, and all of the authors of the independent studies in this report for making it possible for us all to be here today, for raising important issues that I'm sure will have echoes not only today here on Capitol Hill, but in the future, including the near future. It is my task to give a brief introductory overview, which was largely written for a North American audience. I'm not sure that anyone seated here will hear anything new, but you will at least hear, I think, the sort of message that ought to be heard by people in the country where we find ourselves at the moment. Without checks and balances, democracy neither functions nor endures. This is the lesson of history. Absent effective checks on executive power, democracy tends to descend into authoritarianism, and authoritarianism to harden into dictatorship, as we have seen recently in Venezuela. Regrettably, some governments of the left in our hemisphere tend to pursue their ends, whether good, such as benefiting the poor, or bad, such as consolidating a caudillo, at the cost of checks and balances that are especially important for democracy. Among those essential institutions most under attack are independent judiciaries, free and critical media, political dissidents, and social movements. President Rafael Correa of Ecuador, presumably committed to the welfare of his people, appears not to appreciate the indispensable role of checks and balances. To be sure, Ecuador enjoys important elements of democracy, For example, the U.S. State Department Country Report on Human Rights for 2015 acknowledges that President Correa won re-election in 2013 in voting that was, quote, generally free and fair, end quote. The report also recognizes that civilian authorities in Ecuador maintain effective control over the security forces. Nonetheless, according to the report, quote, the main human rights abuses were lack of independence in the judicial sector and restrictions on freedom of speech, press, assembly, and association, end quote, in addition to corruption. The report specifies that judges, quote, reached decisions based on media influence or political or economic pressure in cases where the government expressed interest, end quote. It adds that, according to human rights lawyers, quote, the government also ordered judges to deny all protection action legal motions. I think that's their translation of amparo. To deny all protection action legal motions that argued that the government had violated an individual's constitutional rights to free movement, due process, and equal treatment before the law, end quote. These State Department assessments would doubtless be rejected by President Correa, in fact, they probably have been, as Yankee imperialism unworthy of credence. But similar conclusions can be found in the reports of independent organizations and experts. A serious and credible example is the 2014 report, Independencia Judicial en la Reforma de la Justicia Ecuatoriana, sponsored by three prestigious civil society organizations, the Due Process of Law Foundation based in Washington, De Justicia of Colombia, and the Instituto de Defensa Legal of Peru. The report's author is Luis Pásara of Peru, a recognized expert and academic in matters of judicial independence. According to the three organizations, the evidence in his report, quote, and this is my translation from their Spanish, quote, clearly demonstrates the deplorable use of the judicial system, specifically the criminal justice system, as an instrument at the service of government interests in contravention of respect for judicial independence and with high costs for democratic institutionality, end quote. The Pásara report analyzes 12 cases of social or political importance in Ecuador. And by the way, I think there's one case at least in there that overlaps with one of the cases in the current report, which were prosecuted after the judicial reform of 2011, as well as some 42 resolutions of the Council on the Judiciary issued in other cases during the same period. The author concludes that there, quote, currently exists in Ecuador a political utilization of justice that seriously compromises judicial independence, unquote. Similar conclusions are evidenced in the current report, which in English translation is The Use of the Judiciary to Violate Human Rights in Ecuador, sponsored by the Inter-American Institute for Democracy and the Inter-American Federation of Lawyers. The report presents 6 case studies. According to the sponsoring organizations, these criminal proceedings were used by Ecuadorian authorities to, quote, harass, intimidate, persecute, silence, and prosecute students, indigenous persons, people who denounce corruption, business owners, and political dissidents, end quote. The 6 cases are summarized by their respective authors in the text of the report, and we will hear from a number of them later this morning. And by the way, I invite all of the authors to advise me of any corrections that may be needed. I read these reports, I attempted to extract some very brief summary points, but I may have made some mistakes, and I would welcome any corrections that the authors might observe. I do not pretend here to summarize either the cases or all the violations of due process. It suffices simply to highlight some of the violations in order to illustrate the excesses that appear to have been committed. Now the six cases. In the case of the 10 of Lulunkoto, 10 young people were arrested during a meeting. According to them, the meeting was for the purpose of planning their participation in an indigenous march for water, life, and dignity of peoples. The prosecutors alleged a different motive, an attempt to organize terrorism. However, when the arrests took place, the prosecutors had not identified any specific criminal charge. Worse, in spite of the apparent absence of individualized evidence against the majority of the youths, they were all ordered into pretrial detention, one for 3 months, 7 for 9 months, and 2 for a year. The criminal proceedings then lasted 4 years. In the end, the National Court of Justice dismissed the charges with prejudice. If there were truly evidence that the youths participated in terrorism, is this result credible? The case of Sebastian Ceballos involves a political dissident who, in a series of tweets, disclosed a list of relatives of a high public official, all of whom held government jobs. One tweet stated that Paula Rodas, a niece of the high public official, held her government job, quote, effectively, her uncle is the minister of employment of his family, end quote. The implication was that she had gained her position thanks to her uncle's political clout. But she responded that in fact she won a merit-based competition to earn her position. She filed a criminal complaint against the tweeter for the crime of making, quote, expressions in discredit or dishonor against another, end quote. The tweeter was convicted, fined, and sentenced to 15 days in prison. Nonetheless, once the sentence was confirmed, Ms. Rodas pardoned the tweeter and asked that the case be dropped. In order to avoid prison, the tweeter accepted the arrangement and the court approved it. Both this proceeding and the precedent it sets are troubling. It would have been possible to respond to the tweeter with a public denial or a demand for retraction or clarification or even a civil suit for defamation. But to criminally prosecute for a tweet that implies something negative, but perhaps mistaken about a public official, is disproportionate and threatening to free expression. For example, Principle 11 of the Declaration of Principles on Freedom of Expression, approved by the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights, declares that, quote, public officials are subject to greater scrutiny by society. Laws that penalize offensive expressions directed at public officials, generally known as desacato laws, restrict freedom of expression and the right to information, end quote. In this case, a different law was used to penalize the criticism, but free expression was equally violated. The effect of such criminalization can be to intimidate those who dare to criticize public officials on the internet. Another political dissident, Francisco Daniel Endara Daza, was sentenced to 18 months in prison for the crime of, quote, paralyzing public services, end quote. In the absence of evidence of his direct participation in acts damaging the property of Ecuador TV on 10 September 2010, when there was a sort of police uprising against President Correa, Mr. Endara was convicted for, quote, applauding, end quote, the demonstrators. The unacceptability of both his conviction and his punishment speaks for itself. In another case of, quote, paralyzing public services, end quote, the case of the 29 of Saraguro, an indigenous group blocked the Pan-American Highway. Two of the demonstrators were sentenced to 4 years in prison. Again, the disproportionality of their sentence is obvious. The case of the seizure of the television media TC Televisión and Gamma Visión, was justified on the basis of criminal cases brought against the effective owners of the media enterprises. At first, both the Prosecutor General and the Supreme Court found no basis to prosecute the owners. In response, President Correa, as well as various legislators of his party, publicly declared their disagreement and demanded the dismissal and sanctioning of the judges. The new judges, amenable to Correa's political forces, sentenced the owners to 8 years in prison. Upon examining the case, the Human Rights Committee of the United Nations condemned the seizure of the television properties as a violation of due process. However, despite the dissenting vote of committee member Yuval Shani, the majority did not consider the public statements about the case by President Correa to constitute undue interference with the independence of judiciary. With all respect, I believe that Dr. Shani, and not the majority, was correct. In Ecuador, when President Correa speaks, judges listen. This reality was demonstrated with equal clarity in the sixth case, that of the students of Central Technical High School. 12 students of the school were among 600 students demonstrating against the change of name of the school proposed by the Ministry of Education. The prosecutor in the case decided not to bring charges against the 12 students for lack of sufficient evidence of their guilt. The judge agreed. 2 days later, President Correa criticized the decisions of the prosecutor and judge. He insisted that they were afraid to rule against the students in the face of media pressure. The events were not a simple social protest, he declared, but criminal acts. As long as he remained president, he would not permit this kind of behavior by, quote, muchachos desubicados, end quote, which I have had some difficulty translating, but I've translated as boys acting out of place. 2 days later, the provincial prosecutor revoked the decision not to prosecute and took the 12 students to trial. They were then convicted of rebellion. In other words, by his public declarations in this and other cases of political interest, President Correa has effectively converted himself into the highest court of appeal in Ecuador. Now a note of clarification. In order to analyze violations of due process, it is neither necessary nor relevant to determine the innocence or guilt of the persons being prosecuted. For example, the seizure of the television media, TC Televisión and Gamma Visión, was justified on the basis of criminal cases brought against the owners. There are accusations of corruption against the owners, concerning which I am not sufficiently informed to express an opinion. Nonetheless, for purposes of this report, this does not matter. Even on the assumption of their guilt, bearing in mind the presumption of innocence, there is no justification for violating their right to fair trial. And now, two caveats. The studies in the current report appear to demonstrate violations of judicial independence, as well as the politicized use of criminal trials. However, two caveats should be mentioned. The first is that the authors of some of the studies are the defense lawyers for the accused. This fact diminishes the appearance and possibly the reality of the objectivity of the studies. Nonetheless, even with this limitation, the reports present evidence which is prima facie convincing of irregularities in the trials, as described above. In addition, these studies should be evaluated in the context of other reports by diverse organizations which also criticize the lack of judicial independence in cases of interest to the government in Ecuador. The second caveat is the absence in the report of a response from the state. In the judgment of this writer, it is preferable that reports on violations of human rights in a country, if feasible, invite the observations of the state and include them, or at least a summary, in the report. I don't know whether there was an invitation made in this case. However, in spite of these caveats, the current report is a valuable contribution to public debate about the politicization of justice in Ecuador. In conclusion, the six cases in this report should be cause for concern by everyone committed to judicial independence and to justice free of politics in Ecuador. One hopes that the report may be read, pondered, and debated in Quito. Thank you for your kind attention.
To Dr. Cassel, if anybody in the audience is interested.
And especially if there are any corrections.
Exactly. Yes, Victor.
I have a, from the, it sounds like from the panel, it is like the, and a trend I see also in dealing with cases that a lot of these regimes are using the criminal prosecution angle to obscure their political persecution. And that is obviously done, as you noted, with the judiciary branches and, you know, and prosecutors involved. My question is, process of interior recuperation that you have to wait as the change occurs and the judiciary branch come back to effect. But unfortunately, in the meantime, there are a lot of victims out there. Many victims sometimes will end up over here who I've had to work with over here, with red notices, with conviction records, and then behold, you have FBI, you got Homeland Security, everybody investigating them as criminals, and you have to explain, you know, from piecemeal, case by case, hey, this isn't what it appears to be. My question is, you know, internally, like in a country like the United States, being that we're here, what is your view of how do we address that aspect where some of these clearly biased, controlled judiciaries are emitting all these orders that international organizations and, you know, countries like the U.S. are giving some credibility to that causes further, you know, it's a shame the persecution occurs in your country, and then you're fleeing persecution, only to get whacked again by the local authorities enforcing that same persecution. What's the tactic there to try to address that situation in the U.S., in Western Europe, in other countries that are seeing this? What is out there, you know, aside from individually fighting each case?
Thank you, Rico.
Well, that's a question from an excellent and highly qualified jurist. I know that because Victor Cerda was my student who graduated 21 years ago from DePaul Law School, where I was teaching at the time. Obviously, you had excellent teachers, Victor. But not excellent enough to give you a satisfactory answer to your question. As was explained by my colleagues here on the panel, the use of the judiciary to cloak and disguise repression is, of course, a very clever and attractive technique because it hides repression in the confusion of foreign audiences who are not familiar with the legal procedures in a country, do not know whether the judges there are independent, obviously have not had time to review the expediente in order to examine the evidence, and so from a distance, many people at best can say, well, I don't really know. Maybe this guy's actually corrupt or he's a criminal or not. How can a foreign person know? So in that context, I think there are a number of answers to your question. One is to do exactly the sort of thing which the Inter-American Institute and the Inter-American Bar Association are doing here today and through this report and through the further work on these reports, and that is to try to shed light on the specifics of the cases and to penetrate the confusion and to tell the truth about what's really going on and to try to disseminate that as broadly as possible in countries like the US and Europe, if we can still call Europe a country after Brexit. Secondly, of course, in cases where a person has been convicted by a court in, let us say, Ecuador in one of these unjust prosecutions, the only way for that person to be brought back, of course, is through extradition. And the proceedings in every country, not just this one, for extradition have provisions in them that someone will not be extradited unless there is sufficient good evidence of their guilt. And the very fact that they have been convicted by a foreign tribunal does not necessarily mean that that evidence existed. So resisting extradition is important. It's a little difficult in this country because the procedures of the Justice Department regarding extradition are very private and internal. I've had at least one case where I had sort of half of due process. That is to say, I wrote a letter to the Justice Department after speaking with the Justice Department lawyers on the case, who told me they couldn't even acknowledge that there was a request for extradition. And I sent them a whole legal brief explaining why the criminal conviction of my Venezuelan client was not worth the paper it was written on. I never got a reply, but they did not extradite my client. So there is that sort of, you can speak to them, but you won't know what the reply is except by their action. And then in the case of civil judgments, because the civil proceedings are also used to create confusion, foreign judgments in the United States at least, and I think the same is pretty much true in the European Union, need to be domesticated in order to be enforced, and there are various conditions for domestication. Among those are that the judgment cannot be based on fraud or gross violations of due process. So there are ways to deal with this in a technical legal way, but nonetheless, none of them really get at the fundamental problem that someone has been labeled as a criminal. In these foreign proceedings, you generally can't presume, you can't prove that your client is innocent. And so there's this cloud of suspicion that can be damaging to a person's professional reputation, personal reputation, and business interests that's very hard to get rid of. One final response is of course, to go to the international bodies. In the 1990s, I represented the former boss of Beatrice Rangel, Reynaldo Figueredo, the former minister of the presidency and foreign minister of Venezuela, who had been falsely accused and convicted by the Venezuelan Supreme Court of so-called corruption for his role in sending Venezuelan police bodyguards to protect Violeta Chamorro in Nicaragua after she won the election in 1990 and all the Nicaraguan security forces were still in the hands of the Sandinistas. And as a result of that conviction by the Supreme Court of Venezuela, Reynaldo's reputation was, people thought he was corrupt. He could not get a job anywhere, but we took the case to the Inter-American Commission where we won it. And I think within days after we won the case before the Inter-American Commission, Reynaldo was able to secure very significant positions in the United Nations. So the international proceedings, if you win them, may not necessarily change the result domestically, as Bjorn pointed out, because there may be no way to enforce it, but you can help to regain the person's reputation, which then can give the person new opportunities. I apologize for a long answer, but your question was so brilliant, Victor, that it deserved that response.
Thank you so much. We have
Well, there's good news and there's bad news. The good news is that forced disappearances, massacres, and executions have gone out of style in most of Latin America. We should celebrate that. That's a tremendous advance. If we only think back to the way things were 30 years ago, it was a terrible situation. Now we have most governments in the Americas with various forms of at least the superficial elements of democracy. And if you are a superficial democracy, it's not good for your public relations to go around massacring or disappearing large numbers of people. And so if you want to maintain control effectively, how do you repress and defeat those who criticize you or who are the political opposition, and has been very well explained by Beatrice and Bjorn in their excellent presentations. Using the judiciary, especially if it lacks independence and is controlled, it is an excellent way of repressing while appearing to maintain a facade of democracy. So I think that that's the principal answer, that we now have a new kind of government for whom it is far more convenient to use the courts to create a veneer of legality for repression.
Yes, Bjorn wants to elaborate on this, please. Yes.
Well, no, only maybe add to your very interesting question, the comment that Latin America historically already had all sorts of structural difficulties in building institutions, really strong institutions that fulfill their respective functions. And when the democratic movements started, the real progress of liberalizing and fostering democracy in the 1990s, the judiciary was always the third priority of the governments. It was, you know, a matter of strengthening the government and the parliamentary systems. And I think that many reforms took place over those years. However, the judiciary, well, it was a very expansive endeavor, and maybe not as as attractive from the point of view of the publicity in the reform of the structures of the government. So when then, at the end of the 1990s, start of the 2000s, the new populist movements came to power and took over power, they were still faced with judiciaries in transition. And it was easy for them to take over the judiciaries, strip them of their finances, strip them of the people that were working in them, and put their own people and start really using the judiciary as a repression apparatus, following, and that's my guess only, but following maybe some of the examples used by the former Soviet Union and some of the countries in that area that very systematically, and they use this almost like a way of being in the state, trying to use the judiciary to consolidate the power there. So maybe that helps.
Thank you so much. Concerning this preoccupation of many Latin Americans on why is it so easy for governments to take over the judicial system and use it to violate human rights, I think we need to understand that we have a tradition, an institutional tradition, that leads us to behave like that. As in, Latin America was formed by institutions that were created by Spain, particularly by the sovereign of Spain. This case was Philip II, who was interested in extracting rent from these territories, not creating wealth. There is a big difference between creating wealth and extracting rent. If you want to extract rent, you want to control and suppress every single right, because you need just a very small group of people to be able to extract the riches and take it somewhere else. And the more you exploit the local population, the better off you are. So the institutions are built for that purpose. This is why our economies have been mercantilist throughout our history, and our institutional framework has been corporativist. Now, it is with the emergence of the middle classes in Latin America, which is a phenomenon of the early and mid-20th century, that this has begun to change. And this is why it's so important the role that can play people like Dr. Arp or Dr. Cassel, because it is in the foreign instance that people at the grassroots level who are fighting for their rights that can find support, because you are fighting not only against a repressive government, but there are elites that support them. And so it's a very not level playing field. And it's the international audience and the international institutions that come and level the playing field. Well, with that, let's go to our coffee break, which now is 10 minutes. He has come up with a great idea, which is the idea of how the diasporas of Latin America can contribute to the development of their countries of origin, which is very important because all these diasporas are created by violations of human rights. People escaping oppression come to the United States, or people undergoing a severe economic crisis also come to the United States. And Dr. Blanco has come up with an idea of how these diasporas can be the like Prometheus that brought the light to the mortals, the people that can come and bring knowledge and technology to their countries of origin, thereby making a contribution for development. He has been the director of the Miami-Dade College in the Center for Caribbean and Latin American Initiatives, and right now he is working with a foundation where he is actively engaged in developing projects in order to help his country of origin, Cuba, with the ideas on development and projects on development. He has coordinated this program of research on the judicially articulated violations of human rights in Ecuador, which, as I mentioned this morning, is the first of a series of studies that we are going to conduct. The next one will be probably Venezuela, then Bolivia, and Argentina, and all the countries where this violation seems to be part and parcel of the regime's ideologies. Without much ado, I am going to please ask Juan Antonio to present the project and his panelists. Thank you.
Is this working?
No.
Thanks for being here. Thanks for being here at almost 11 something, 11:10. Thank you at least for being my friend and being so nice to me in these introductions. I'm embarrassed of all the merits that you're attributing to me. Nevertheless, I am not going to forgive you that you preempted the introduction to my presentation, because you took this marvelous quotation of Correa, which was also my idea to start this with this idiotic thing of one ruler to say explicitly that he believes, like in the old times, that l'état c'est moi, you know, I am going to be the executive branch, the judiciary branch, the legislative branch, and so on. It's such, you know, a great thing that Correa said that so candidly, that he laid out this paradigm of the new dictatorship of the 21st century, like former president, Ecuadorian president Osvaldo Hurtado used to call them, that I also thought, like Beatrice, to start my presentation with that. I am not going to punish you by repeating it. You know it by now. And as of the readers of this book will soon find out, there is also no difference between Correa's rhetoric and his presidential practice. The judicial practices carried out against various Ecuadorian citizens and now compiled in this book by six independent authors and with very different backgrounds are clear evidence on how far President Correa has implemented his dictatorial vision on the judicial branch of his country. The six cases we now present to you unfortunately represent not the exception, but the actual trend in the way that justice is administered under Correa. The commitment to the national constitution, international human rights covenants, and the democratic charter of the OAS are all conveniently swept aside to expediently punish those who dare to contradict the will of the autocrat and his servants. The Inter-American Institute for Democracy and the Inter-American Bar Association did not take up this research as a political task, but as an academic responsibility. In this book, you will not find political statements, but the objective and detailed reports of lawyers and scholars narrating six cases that experience pervasive intrusion of the executive branch in an already weakened and submissive judiciary. Throughout the book, the reader will get a closer look at the government of Ecuador's continuous attempts to harass, intimidate, persecute, neutralize, and put on trial members of every segment of Ecuadorian society: students, indigenous people, entrepreneurs, political dissidents, and whistleblowers on corruption. At the Inter-American Institute for Democracy, we are too familiar with the pattern of governance that is common in some degree or another to all governments that have embraced the so-called socialism of the 21st century. And I would like to dedicate these closing remarks at the end of today's session to that broader theme. What is the current connection between those regimes governed by the paradigm that Correa described and the broader arc of anti-democratic forces in the region and in the world? I am afraid that a prominent weakness of too many foreign affairs analysts is their fragmented vision of reality. The same way that many agencies in pre-9/11 USA failed to see the connecting dots between various ongoing events, some international experts now tend to separate their analysis of interconnected events as well as the behavior of some key players. Consequently, they keep addressing secondary questions on isolated processes instead of formulating a comprehensive vision of their significance. Allow me to present you with three brief reflections on this matter. My first remark is to raise a question. What is the present danger to democratic regimes throughout the world? From my perspective, we are facing a new unholy alliance between authoritarian and totalitarian states, some secular, some theocratic, some authoritarian-prone political parties, irregular terrorist forces, and international crime cartels, which are all linked to those totalitarian states and the irregular forces that they sponsor. During the Cold War, the issue of containing communism was the organizing idea for analysts and policymakers that cemented Western alliances. No new organizing idea will emerge until we see the dots now connecting these different players currently confronting the values of democracy and human rights throughout the world. Retired Lieutenant General Michael T. Flynn mentions in his recently published book, The Field of Battle, that an unstructured and loose alliance of countries and groups share their hatred of the West. I would add that not only those countries mentioned by Flynn, such as North Korea, Russia, China, Cuba, and Venezuela, but also others, such as Nicaragua, Syria, and Iran, are relevant players in that undeclared anti-Western alliance. Why was the cooperation with the DEA the first target to be attacked when the leaders of the so-called socialism of the 21st century came to power in Bolivia and Ecuador? How can a certificate of good conduct be extended to Havana while Venezuela, a country under close control of Cuban intelligence and military advisors, is heavily engaged in drug trafficking? When are we finally going to connect the dots? My second remark is about the pervasive strategy that these global actors pursue through different local parties with a Leninist approach to power. Political movements and parties, such as Alianza País in Ecuador or Podemos in Spain, seek to get elected only to start a process of gradually dismantling democracy. Following a careful political strategy designed by Fidel Castro immediately after the fall of the Soviet Union, the rise of those types of parties and politicians was fostered by the millionaire financial support extended to them by the late Hugo Chavez when the value of a barrel of oil was beyond $110 in the global markets. Nothing could be clearer to that respect than the direct quotation of President Correa showing his twisted understanding of the unlimited powers that he claims he was allegedly granted to reign over the country. Once elected to the head of the executive branch of government, these dictatorial prone politicians aim to blow up the pillars of a democratic regime, the separation of powers, and a system of check and balances among them, combined with full respect to personal liberties and legal due process. These political players see elections as just another way to achieve power, but they do not seek a provisional power. They aim to install themselves as a permanent power that from then on would guide a transition from a democratic regime to an authoritarian or even totalitarian regime. Those represent a new species of governments. For more than a decade, the alliance between all these anti-Western governments has made itself felt in regional multilateral institutions, such as the Organization of the American States and the Council on Human Rights of the United Nations, where they have sought actively to occupy seats or to gather together so that their vote would have enough weight to block those resolutions that they don't like, because those resolutions expose their violations of human rights to the rest of the region or the world. These anti-democratic forces effectively concert their actions in those forums in an attempt to neutralize any criticism and even to attack their opponents. Unless we finally come to acknowledge that such an international anti-democratic collaborative coalition exists, we will not be able to identify and neutralize their tactics. My third brief and last remark is just another question. How can we identify these challenges at an early stage? What signs could we use to recognize when a particular government is starting to align with these anti-Western players? Simple. When they start to locally undermine the separation of powers and the system of check and balances between them. With Ecuador, this process started early under President Correa, but again, only a few were connecting the dots at that time. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now we are going to give the floor. We're going to give the floor to Dr. Daniela Salazar Marin. She's going to present us the case, the Judiciary is a tool to silence freedom of expression online in Ecuador. Dr. Salazar is a very distinguished scholar from Ecuador, who is the deputy president of the University of San Francisco, who has had a very distinguished teaching career and who has participated actively in this research given to the whole project, not only credibility, but a lot of insight into how this government aims to repress freedom of expression in Ecuador operate. Please, Dr. Salazar.
Good morning, everybody. First of all, please excuse my English. It's not what it used to be, but I'm going to try my best. Thank you very much to the Inter-American Democracy Institute, especially to James for these invitations, for putting it all together, and for the Inter-American Bar Association, and for all of you who are here. If you're here, it's because you're interested in the human rights situation in Ecuador, and that is already a lot to say. It's not a country that has drawn too much international attention. And sometimes it feels very hopeless to be in Ecuador, where the judiciary is not going to protect you from any human rights violation. And if I know something, is that Correa really cares about his international image. And so if international actors can start moving to put a little pressure on Correa, that might actually have a change in the situation of human rights in Ecuador. So thank you very much for being here. Writing a book about basically corruption between Correa's government, Correa's brother and the government. There is another very famous case of El Universo where Emilio Palacio wrote an opinion piece in this diary, El Universo, and they were convicted to pay $40 million to damages to Correa's image also for this case. And in this context, Correa approved a law, they passed a law in the government in 2013, a media law that has basically caused a lot of censorship. There is an executive government, a superintendency, that controls the media and fines them weekly for anything they say against the government. And this has caused that, in order to survive, media have resorted to self-censorship. Yeah. And so anything you see on the media, anything that's really happening, you don't really see on the media. And that's why I wanted to tell you this, because social media, whatever happens on the internet, has become very important place to denounce human rights violations. If there is a protest, you cannot see that on the media. If there is a case that has not yet been decided by the judges, you will not read that on the media. Where can you find that information, and where is most of the public debate taking place in Ecuador? On social media, because they have not been able to control social media through this law. So that's why I picked this case on freedom of expression on the internet, because the government has realized that, and now it's eager to control the internet as well. Also still on context, in 2011, the government received a popular mandate to carry out an extensive judicial reform. Yes, the judicial power was before very questioned. There was a lot of corruption in the judicial power, and so Correa received this very broad mandate to reform justice. And what they did is that they appointed and removed hundreds of judges through very questionable mechanisms. And that is how today Correa controls the judicial power. It is in this context that I am going to present you with this case. It's not one of the most renowned internationally cases on human rights violations in Ecuador. When I was asked by James to identify a case where the judiciary has played a role in the human rights violation in Ecuador, I was trying to find a case where nothing would have happened if the judiciary had not acted. So there was no protests, no military, no police involvement, nothing would have happened. The human rights violations started the day that the judiciary started acting, and that is what happened in this case. The facts, very briefly, this happened last year, around the end of July. His name is Sebastián Ceballos. He's a very young, not even very famous, but like a political leader in Cuenca, a very beautiful city in the south of Ecuador. And he used information, public information, just to find out how many people who were family members of a very high minister, the Ministry of Labor, how many of his relatives were working for his government, which is prohibited by the law in Ecuador. And so he identified more than 20 relatives of this ministry who were in different positions throughout the government. And he put that in his social media, his Twitter account. There was a series of Twitters just denouncing, well, there is this person who has this relationship to the ministry and is working here. And he just put together a lot of information on that. And that is all he did. One of his tweets, and once again, a niece of this ministry, and it literally just says this: Paula Rodas, that was her name, Paula Rodas, niece of Carlos Marx, that is the name of the ministry, Carlos Marx, Ministry of Labor too, which is a little ironic, but okay, I'll go back to my case. Paula Rodas, the niece of Carlos Marx Carrastro, works for this institution. And then there was an opinion. He said, he's literally the Ministry of Labor of his family. Just to put it like a little ironically, that is all he said in his tweet. So Paula Rodas felt offended that someone would question why she was there. She had been working for the government for like 6 years before she actually had a contest on merits. But she thought no one should question that she was there on her own merits. And instead of maybe just tweeting also in her account that this is not true, or you know why she's there or what her merits are, maybe even a press release or something like that would have been sufficient. If there was any misinterpretation about why she was working for the government. But she prefers to use criminal law, as many people are doing in Ecuador. The tweet had two facts. She's the niece, she's working for the government, and an opinion. There is no hate speech, no incitement to violence, nothing. But you can still use criminal law in Ecuador against these cases. And so he was criminally prosecuted for allegedly attempting to her reputation. When I moved back to Ecuador in 2009 and I started studying some of the judicial decisions, they were very poorly analyzed compared to anything I had been studying, for example, here in the United States when I had the chance to do my LLM here. And I thought maybe the lawyers are at fault. And I thought maybe if we as lawyers put out good arguments, then the courts will have to incorporate those arguments and at least respond to them, and then the level would raise. And this case shows that is not enough. In this case, the prosecution showed nothing. There was just a tweet. The lawyer for Paula Rodas based his whole argument on her being a woman and how a woman should never be discredited for that, because she's a mother and because she comes from a very honorable family. That was his whole argument. And on the other side, the defense put up a brilliant defense. They really used all international human rights standards on freedom of expression to state why this is first public information. There's just nothing wrong. He wasn't even a whistleblower. It's just public information available to anybody. He was just doing his duty as a citizen to control the government and to criticize or question, you know, what's happening with public funds. And it was protected speech. The defense was brilliant explaining why this is protected speech, political speech, under international human rights standards. But the judges are not up to these arguments at all. I can't even analyze the legal reasoning of the judge because there is none. There is zero there. It's completely lacking any reasoning. The judge didn't do a test explaining, you know, there are two rights in conflict, freedom of expression, her reputation, nothing at all. The judge has such a limited comprehension of the law that faced with this argument on protected speech, the judge says this was not speech, literally speech, because it's a tweet. And I guess for the judge, you can only give a speech if you're, I don't know, I guess standing with a microphone in front of 1,000 persons and giving a political speech. Literally, that's a speech, but anything else was not a speech for the judge. His comprehension on the use of internet and how the internet works, also very limited. In fact, when he takes the evidence against Sebastian Ceballos, the judge does not only convict him for this tweet, but also for 11 retweets. So you can be criminally liable for pressing a retweet button, which does it with opinions from other people, which does, you know, you didn't do anything to say you agree with it or anything like that. And so that's how Sebastian was convicted to 15 days of jail time, which doesn't sound like a lot compared to some of the cases you're going to hear today, where people have been convicted to 4 or 6 years of jail time. But we're talking about someone who's he just said something, he wrote something on a tweet, and it's absolutely disproportionate that he has to go to jail for that. Of course, this judicial decision was confirmed on appeal, and there was nothing to do there. And the reason why I chose this case is because it has had a devastating chilling effect on everyone else. I can tell you myself. And to maybe answer Douglas Cassell's, one of his caveats, I was not a lawyer on the case. I don't know Sebastian Ceballos. I've never met him. But this impacted me. I feel like if I had had that information on the ministry, I may have tweeted it too. I those things worry me too. I could have written the same exact tweet, and I don't want to go 15 days to jail. And so I think five times before I say anything in Ecuador or before I tweet anything in Ecuador. And I know that's how a lot of people feel, because of the chilling effect of having to maybe face jail for something that you are supposed to do or you're supposed to say anyways. And this is not an isolated case. There are many cases like this where people who are in power have used criminal law to silence their critics. In fact, last week, or maybe 2 weeks ago, the vice mayor of Quito, also he gave an interview in the radio, and he's also been convicted to jail because he offended President Correa. So he's appealing right now, but he will probably go to jail, even if it's 15 days, 30 days. This is not an isolated case. It's happening all the time in Ecuador. And what it shows to me is that no matter how small or how big the case is, if you are facing government interests in a judicial case in Ecuador, you have no hope. No judge would ever decide a case against a government interest in Ecuador. I also wanted to bring up this case here because there is something you can do here in the States to protect the internet and freedom of speech in internet. Correa cannot use the media law to sanction free opinions on social media. The law expressly excludes that from its mandate. However, Correa has figured out that the DMCA, a law here in the United States, allows any person to take down content from social media, from Twitter, from YouTube, just by claiming that that content is violating intellectual property rights. And Correa is doing that all the time. People who use, for example, a picture of Correa taken from his official account, or Correa in a public speech, and anybody using that picture to post any information that's maybe uncomfortable for the government, Correa is saying, those are my intellectual property rights, because that picture is mine. And with that, he takes down content from the internet every week on questionable grounds. Now, let me tell you how this case finished. After he was convicted and in appeal that was confirmed, he was pardoned. He was pardoned by, he was pardoned by Paula Rodas. Now, this is not isolated either. Correa did the same with these cases I told you at the beginning, in the case of El Universo and the case in El Gran Hermano. Correa waited till those convictions were set, and then he pardoned the victims. And that tells you two things. First, that leaves you with no international human rights mechanism of relief. Yeah, you may have the relief that you're not going to jail, or in the case of El Gran Hermano, you don't have to pay $40 million. That sounds great. But you could never bring your case to the Inter-American Commission or the Human Rights Committee at the United Nations because your case was solved internally. And that's worrisome. But even more worrisome is that, and I find this very dangerous, the message that it sends. The message that this sends is that the only source of justice in Ecuador is the executive power or the president himself. That's the source of justice. You cannot get justice from the judges. The justice comes from the good heart of the president. And that is how people feel right now in Ecuador. thanks to these cases. So I know I only have 15 minutes and I don't want to take more than that. My clock says I did 15 minutes already, but I can respond to any questions now or later, if you may. Later, he says. Okay, thank you very much.
Question is here.
Okay, no?
Because at the end of the day, you're not going to appeal your conviction. Maybe that has some further comments on that.
I think technically you're right, but in practice, it effectively bars international action because it reduces the level of the case so that, for example, in the European system, you know the new language about unless there's substantial injury or something, it wouldn't pass that hurdle in the European system. And in the inter-American system, the resources are so limited that they have to really prioritize the most serious cases, and this drops it below the bar. So technically you're right, but as a practical matter, I think it does effectively end any real possibility of international review.
Yes, and to accept it, and when you accept it, then you also commit to not bringing this, you know, any farther in injustice. And then, as Douglas, Professor Cassel just said, if the case has been solved, the Inter-American Commission will probably not take it, or the state would have a really good defense saying, this has been solved already. There is nothing else that can be said internationally. But political pressure measures are still there, and so that's why I wanted to use this case here.
The president didn't pardon $100,000, which he then used to buy an apartment in Belgium. Of course, he didn't pardon them. He took the money and he used it, which, by the way, takes the whole thing to a very different terrain, which is corruption. Because when a sitting president, goes around suing for libel for opinions, that is called corruption. You cannot do that in a democracy.
Interesting, because what you just said is something you could never say in Ecuador right now. That is exactly what this is exactly what the vice mayor said a couple weeks ago in his radio interview. What we're saying here, in his interview, he claimed that Correa was using the judicial power to get money and send that money to Belgium. That's all he said. He actually didn't mention Correa. He just said it generally. Justice is being used to get money and send it to Belgium. And he's been convicted to jail already, so.
Well, this has been live stream, so I don't know yet about
it. Good luck. I'll give you my card, I'm a lawyer. I can try my best in Ecuador.
Thank you so
thank
much,
you.
Give her a round of applause. Okay, now we move to the judicial misuse of political repression with Dr. Jaime Vintimilla. As his professor Vintimilla is a faculty member of San Francisco University Law School and a professor at the graduate program in law at the Andean Simón Bolívar University in Quito and Alcalá de Henares in Spain. He has written more than 35 articles and books about constitutional and financial law, also about arbitration, mediation, history, genealogy, and the Indian justice. Let's welcome Professor Vintimilla.
To everybody, it's really a privilege to be here, and unfortunately I have just a short time to express some ideas about the case that I had to draft. Well, the title is Terrorism Forged in a Constitutional State of Law, because in Ecuador, I think I forgot something very important. Maybe because I'm thinking right now in English. I have to thank first. But I have to thank, you know, the IID for the great possibility to speak about the weakness of the judiciary, the Ecuadorian judiciary, that in my opinion right now is destroying the rule of law. Or maybe I have a question, maybe it's reframing it. And take it, the substantive use by the Professor Cassel, we have five caveats in Ecuador, at least. My first caveat. I think we have a new concept, a new definition of coup d'etat. Because right now, it's not perpetrated by military forces. I guess it's perpetrated by lawyers. Because if you compare Venezuela, Nicaragua, Ecuador, and other similar countries, they all start with a constituent process in order to draft a new constitution. And all the people vote for them, and they are happy. They all live in a paradise, a legal paradise. And they have new rules, but they have to face ancient mistakes, all mistakes. And I think that's my first caveat. My second caveat, the judges are selected by merits. At least it is what they say. It's written in the rules. But if you see the conditions, the requirements to be a candidate, you will find a link strongly, you know, connected with the power. Advisors of the president, ministers, and they do whatever they do. They have all the power to do everything. Because in one year, they are ministers or something, and the next year, they will change, and they will be whatever. No problem. They are, you know, capable for everything. My third caveat has to do with two types of judicial cases that must be faced in Ecuador. And this morning, we were talking with Daniela. I think the first one has to do with the common people. You know, I have to be with property, has to be with just private interests. But we have a second sort of cases in which the interest is of the power. We have a government interest in which the judicial methods and techniques, of course, will change. My fourth caveat has to do with the necessary definition or redefinition of what really means a good and effective democracy. Because I think democracy is very important. It's even a right. But in countries like Ecuador, where we have poverty, that we have corruption, must be linked to the necessity to cover that people need to eat, that people need to go to school, and that the authoritarians use it for a new way to get the power and empathize these people. So how, my caveat is, how will link principles, institutions with the main problems that people must face every day? And my last caveat is about the Constitution. It's really a legal frame to face and control the power, or is just a structure to facilitate the power of the person? L'état c'est moi, it's the rule to govern, not 2 centuries ago, but today. So I think we are living a sort of backlash to the absence of law. I guess that's a regional problem that we have to face, that we have to study, that we have to understand, and not just at school, but in the cultural level, we need to understand what is going on this. Going to the case, I think the case is just one more of the cases within a path that is full of lack of independence, especially in those procedures, as I said before, that have to do with political interests of the government. This case will enter into judicial history like the trial of the worst and darkest episode of the Ecuadorian judiciary since innocent people were condemned according to pressure coming from the government servants. Without any doubt, the case will be remembered as one of the signs of the great failure of the judicial system. At least that is my conviction. But what we have to see in a short period of time, what we can see about this, how we describe this case, that, by the way, Professor, he made a great job, you know, doing a brief description of every case. The purpose, I think, why I dare to write something about this case, because I tried, at least the case seeks to show the serious violations of human rights that occur during the conduct of proceedings before different courts, being the most relevant the abuse of various precautionary measures, cautelar measures, as well the transgression of the principle of criminal doctrine of consistency through a distorted and even fanciful interpretation and application of any principles of Ecuadorian law, really universal law, but one is jura nobis curia, principle that which led us down to the dark of criminal law of the enemy. And I think that's very important, because the penal principles, the penal law, is using not just to criminalize, it's used like, I would dare to say, not just ideology, but a program to control the citizen that are against the government, tries to discipline the citizens that are against the government, or just they are thinking in a diverse way. About the key facts and issues, I just want to say very concrete. I want to be concrete. And what happened? Okay. On November 2011, bombas pamphletarias, using like pamphlet bombs, but I don't know if it's the same sense, but I decided just to describe like that. Three pamphlet bombs exploded in Quito, Guayaquil, and Cuenca. These detonations were related to the group of popular fighters, of popular combatants. On March the 3rd, 2012, the police operation called Red Sun, really was Puka Indi in Quechua, began with the raid of an apartment located in Lulungkoto, which is a southern neighborhood located in Quito. Since they proceeded to arrest 10 young people who were just meeting, trying to decide their participation in the march announced by the indigenous movement in defense of water, dignity, and life against mining, which should arrive in Quito on March 22nd of 2012. Besides, all the accused were students by the time, or young professionals who have completed their study, their careers in state universities, and have also had some experience of leadership. According to one testimony of them, the date of the arrest, they met only to study the Constitution, they said, as well to discuss diverse problems of the country. This reality leads us to the inevitably two readings of the meaning. One comes from the people themselves gather and accuse, while the other comes from the police, interior ministry, and judicial servants of officials. The problem is that the second version was the unique use by the judicial system. And that is terrible because the prosecutor and the judges found a crime where just was not possible to find evidence. You know what the police found? 20 bucks. Just books, photographs of Che Guevara, something without importance. I don't know if I have a book just about philosophy, I'm gonna be a philosopher. I will bet I would love to be treated like that. But that was really the situation. Just a last point about the key issues. Was very tough the behavior of the police, because two specialized groups met into the apartment where people, they just get in, and were members of the intervention and rescue group and unit for combating organized crime. They raided the place and they, got into the jail to the people. This is terrible because the prosecutor launched an investigation just based on this evidence that I said before. And that, I think, is terrible. That's, again, the provisions of the Constitution. And in my opinion, as of the many people, this invalidates the arrest, the search, and the seizure of property members of the group. Something that is terrible also is the time that takes the procedure, 4 years. And even with a new constitution and with a new penal law in which the penal type disappeared, the national court took 2 years in order to understand that they have the possibility to say that these people is innocent. Something very, very strange. In order of time, the legal reasoning. I think within the present case, the judge and the prosecutor forget any form of legal reasoning, since they don't use neither deductive reasoning nor linear reasoning, and it is not capable to use analogy. Unfortunately, the judicial servant just use the arbitrariness as a background of their decisions, reckoning on the pressures of executive branch. I think if you don't see the case like that, it is not comprehensible the violation of many rights, due process, special procedural defense, presumption of innocence, physical and psychological integrity, privacy, reputation, etc. So you will find, I don't know if I have more time. I'm on time.
2 minutes.
Okay, so I will finish then. What human rights have been violated in this arbitrary procedure and why? Well, at least 10 rights that are within the Constitution. A lot rights that are in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, as well as in the American Declaration of Human Rights, but above all, in Constitution, the right to due process of law, and in particular, the presumption of innocence, evidence duly and legally acted, the right of persons to defense, especially the guarantees that guarantees prohibition of deprivation of the right of defense, have the time and the means to proper defense, be heard in the timely and equal, present evidence and contradict those filed against verbal or written, etc., etc. Just to finish, I would like to express conclusions. This case allows us to see a clear imbalance between the different branches of government and the lack of both internal as external judicial independence. Why? Because government needs to create a ghost. What is the ghost? That we don't have security. And what's the best way to cover the security? Finding innocent people and call them terrorists. On the absence of external independence, a strong influence and interference from the executive branch to the various institutions involved in the administration of justice is undoubtedly observed. Pressure exerted through a kind of superior hero figure, since the case is seen as a media game, as well as the generation of a specific enemy that must be fought with enemies for the benefit of national security. Relying on distorted interpretations and on the basis of the above premises described, a violation of several fundamental rights, where due process is the most acknowledged, shows the return to the top of the authoritarianist expression, l'état c'est moi, and the state. Thank you very much.
Okay, buenos días. Mi exposición va a ser en español. La insuficiencia del inglés para ciertos conceptos en mí es notoria y obvia. Hablamos de casos y hablamos del sistema judicial. En crisis en todo el mundo. En Ecuador no existe. En Ecuador hay un apéndice del Poder Ejecutivo que le han puesto toga, la han separado en el presupuesto y le han puesto un nombre que dice función judicial, que no es otra cosa que sí, que la función judicial que realiza la decisión del Ejecutivo. Eso es obvio, está dicho en muchos informes y en casos concretos, como el caso que hoy día me toca a mí relatar, que es el caso de Isaías, llegó al Comité de Derechos Humanos de las Naciones Unidas, se logró un dictamen a los 35 años contra el Estado del Ecuador, en el cual se condena al Estado del Ecuador por las confiscaciones de los medios de comunicación, entre otros bienes, por haber violado el debido proceso. Quiero llamar la atención a los juristas aquí presentes de algo que no se ha destacado con la suficiente trascendencia. El Pacto Internacional de los Derechos Civiles y Políticos no reconoce y protege el derecho de propiedad. Sin embargo, en el caso Isaías, a través de la vulneración del derecho al debido proceso, como medida de reparación, ordena evidentemente retornar, restaurar, compensar, indemnizar la propiedad perdida por el indebido proceso de confiscaciones. Eso para Ecuador ha significado un gran estímulo en el foro jurídico de saber que la instancia internacional está respondiendo. No obstante, 4 años de litigio, está respondiendo con un voto fuera del voto unánime, un voto sorprendente del voto israelita, que en materia penal va a servirme de hilo conductor en esta brevísima exposición. ¿Qué es lo que falla en el sistema judicial en el mundo entero? El factor decisión judicial. Muy pocos autores, tratadistas, académicos y profesores tratan el tema de la decisión judicial. Desde la vieja polémica hardworking sobre si la decisión de los jueces es discrecional o no, nos hemos quedado con la interrogante. ¿Los jueces deciden discrecionalmente o no? Y sobre todo en materia penal. Quiero decirles con mucha decepción del que habla que no conozco un fallo penal en el Ecuador que no sea discrecional. Y no conozco, sino rarísimas excepciones, fallos motivados en materia penal que mantengan un orden de precedentes jurisprudenciales o dogmáticos. Esa es la crisis que hay en la credibilidad judicial. ¿Hasta dónde la discreción de los jueces? ¿Por qué tiene esto tanta trascendencia? Porque no hay democracia posible sin jueces. Y no porque lo digamos líricamente o porque lo hayan dicho los precursores de la democracia en la civilización, sino por una cuestión casi matemática y mecánica. Si los derechos de las personas no admiten discusión, ni desde Obama a Putin o desde Estados Unidos a Turquía, nadie se atreve a decir que no hay derechos humanos. Se ha convenido mundialmente que la justicia es la realización de los derechos humanos. Y por lo tanto, que las normas jurídicas se hacen y contienen la protección a los derechos humanos. Quienes pueden faltar a los derechos humanos es el Ejecutivo. Quienes pueden faltar a los derechos humanos es el legislador. Pero el único que los puede proteger es el juez. Si el juez no protege los derechos, no hay quien lo haga. Y si no hay quien lo haga, ¿de qué democracia estamos hablando? Por lo tanto, la premisa es, los jueces son una necesidad inexcusable de la democracia. Cuando el Poder Ejecutivo captura, aprehende, secuestra, encarcela a los jueces, es dueño de los derechos. Y si hay un dueño de los derechos, ya no hay derechos. Eso sucede en el Ecuador. Bien lo mencionaba la brillante profesora que me precedió en la palabra. En el 2011, mediante consulta popular, típica arma de las dictaduras populistas, desde Hitler, Hitler gobernó siempre en base a consultas populares. La ley de las camas vacías fue aprobada por el 99% de la población alemana, que permitió el experimento en los niños y en los infantes. El pueblo alemán apoyó por mayoría absoluta muchas leyes. Igual que Correa, consiguió que el pueblo ecuatoriano apoye por mayoría el que exista un consejo de la judicatura en el Ecuador, conformado por 5 delegados de él, que podían disciplinar a los jueces. En otras palabras, traduzcamos esto sin eufemismos, ordenar a los jueces lo que al gobierno le interesaba, que tuvieron el membrete y tienen el membrete de asuntos institucionales. Cuando se trata de un asunto institucional, el juez ni se atreve a dudar de que le manden el pendrive para ponerlo y hacerlo sentencia. Y esa es la labor judicial más la firma. Por lo tanto, eso, esa pantomima en Ecuador no le llama función judicial. Vamos a los objetivos. En el caso Isaías, el objetivo era uno de los que no puede privarse el socialismo del siglo XXI como mandato programático, el Estado propaganda. El Estado propaganda implica dominar los medios de comunicación, o al menos moderarlos o silenciarlos. En el Ecuador se decidió los dos sistemas. Con el Universo fue la primera intención de quebrar el periódico, de crear la bancarrota del periódico. Y se logró salvar la bancarrota del periódico por una medida cautelar de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos. Una vez más, la justicia supranacional reemplazó la falencia de los jueces, entre comillas, jueces ecuatorianos. Y eso detuvo la ejecución de la condena que todavía subsiste contra Diario El Universo, tanto penal como civil. En el caso de Isaías, había que confiscar los medios de comunicación, dos medios, entre otros, de nivel nacional y de primera opción. ¿Qué tuvieron que hacer? Crear un proceso penal por la entrega de Filambanco al Estado ecuatoriano con superávit. Y después de 15 años de proceso, óigaseme bien, 15 años de proceso, sin acusación fiscal por delito de peculado, decide los jueces de la Corte Nacional de Justicia que constituía peculado bancario el haber inobservado normas del programa de estabilización del banco sin pérdida para el banco, sin beneficio para los accionistas, sin beneficio para nadie y sin perjuicio para nadie, era peculado. Y el artilugio de palabras que las utilizan para adecuar la conducta al peculado es digna de una historia de Ripley que ya la relataremos oportunamente. Este caso fue llevado en su contexto a las Naciones Unidas. Comité, como ustedes saben, conformado por 18 especializados de altísimo nivel. Está conformado por culturas distintas, no solo por derechos distintos. Estaba en esa comisión el 30 de marzo del 2016, en que se realizó la última votación, Estados Unidos, Gran Bretaña, Japón, Alemania, Italia, Israel, Congo, Armenia, Georgia, Mauritania, Mauricio, Polonia. Es decir, no creo que estas culturas y diferentes maneras de observar el derecho y concepciones incluso del derecho no hayan podido ver lo que vieron y se sorprendieron. De que el Estado ecuatoriano, el 8 de julio, declare la confiscación de los medios de comunicación. El 9 de julio, al día siguiente, la Asamblea Constituyente del Ecuador, comandada por el presidente Correa, declaró que esa confiscación era legítima. Pero no solo eso, sino que era tan legítima que en el artículo 2 prohibió que cualquier juez pueda revisar el acto dictado de confiscación. Y no solamente eso, en el artículo 3 dijo que si algún juez se atrevía, sería destituido y perseguido penalmente, dicho en el propio mandato de la Asamblea Constituyente. Tanto así que en uno de los juicios en el estado de la Florida, cuando se leyó este mandato 13, el juez de primera instancia, juez Thornton, si mal no recuerdo, lo leyó, le preguntó al abogado del Estado ecuatoriano si por si acaso él quería saber si ese mandato también era contra él, que si él revocaba o opinaba en contra también. Y el Estado del Ecuador dijo que sí, que era contra cualquier juez. En consecuencia, el juez se rió muy respetuosamente y dejó el mandato. Hemos llegado a esos extremos. Por esa razón, nunca en ningún auditorio se le ha negado la razón en el caso de Isaías. Pero yo quiero concluir solamente ya reflexionando en algo. Señores, tomemos en cuenta de dos conclusiones que vamos a extraer de aquí. Uno, La democracia sin jueces no existe. Hay crímenes contra la humanidad reconocidas en los simposios internacionales. Yo propongo que este instituto lleve adelante la idea de crímenes contra la democracia. Y la primera es cuando se captura la función judicial, se secuestra la función judicial y se utiliza la función judicial para meternos a todos en un solo tonel de indignidad humana que es la que vive actualmente mi Ecuador. Muchas gracias.
Gracias, doctor Zavala, por esa excelente exposición y además por esa excelente idea que le prometo le vamos a hacer gracias. Seguimiento.
Muy amable.
Y quisiéramos que usted presidiera esa cruzada.
Será un honor, será un honor.
Con muchísimo gusto. Hay preguntas para el doctor Zavala, pero vamos a darle la bienvenida al congresista Joaquín Castro, que nos acompaña, si por favor hiciera su
Good afternoon. It's wonderful to be here with you, and I wanted to come by. I know that my colleague, Ileana Ross-Leighton, is going to address you in her closing remarks in a few minutes. My name is Joaquin Castro, and I am a congressman from Texas. I represent the wonderful city of San Antonio, and I sit on the Foreign Affairs Committee, and specifically the Western Hemisphere Subcommittee that, of course, looks at our relationship with Latin America and the Caribbean, and we are interested in making sure that Latin America and, of course, every place around the world is a democratic society for its people, is a place of freedom, a place that respects human rights, and does so through all of the institutions of government, whether it's the executive branch, the legislative branch, or, of course, the judiciary. And so I came today mostly to listen and to get a briefing from folks about the situation in Ecuador. But thank you also for highlighting this issue, for bringing it to our attention, and for doing it here in our building so that we can come by and say hello. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I have to thank the International Institute for. You have to excuse me because I'm not a native language, but you have to excuse me because I'm not a native language. But the purpose of this presentation is to describe how my client, who is here, prosecution and to a final sentence of 18 months in prison, only for the information from provide broadcasting. Facing this, it's important to make. On September 29, 2010, the National Assembly of Ecuador passes a law decreasing the bonuses and remunerations of the members of the national police. On September 30, 2010, members of the national police met in the building of the main headquarters located in Quito in order to express their disconformity to request changes in the new legislation. President Correa, in person, went to the police headquarters in order to claim for this indiscipline. This unexpected action led the collective alarm, both in all members of the national police that decided to stop rendering their services in general to citizens that did not support the text of the new law and considered that the actions of the executive were contrary to good sense and to correct behavior. The president decreed a status of exception in the whole country, forbidding private means of communication to transmit news in the event. In that fact, only the public TV channel called Ecuador TV was allowed to provide information during the day. The people in Quito react against the attitude of the executive, against right of freedom, free information and free speech, and several citizens claim through demonstrations in the streets to reestablish the right of freedom of expression through the private TV channel broadcastings. Under these circumstances, about 200 persons headed to the facilities of Ecuador TV trying to express their opinion on the situation. Two of them were able to speak in the channel, and Francisco Endara only limited his presence to stay calm and quiet in the facilities of this public channel. Alleging without evidence, several criminal investigations were conducted by the General Public Prosecutor or under his orders. One of these investigations was brought against Francisco Endara, whom the prosecutor in charge accused of being author of omission because he alleged that he did not stop the action of the people in spite of his obligation to prevent the crime. However, on August 26, 2011, the fifth criminal judge of Quito issued an indictment against Francisco Endara, who is my client, in order to bring against him a trial for sabotage and terrorism. On March 8, 2014, the Second Court of Criminal Guarantees rendered a decision sentencing Mr. Endara to 4 years of imprisonment, considering him as an author of sabotage. An appeal was filed against such decision to the Criminal Chamber of the Provincial Court of Pichincha that reduced the sentence to 2 years in the basis that Francisco Endara has acted as a complice. In cassation, the Criminal Chamber of National Court of Justice changed the qualification of the crime to paralyzation of public service and reduced the sentence to 18 months. A constitutional action known as Action of Extraordinary Protection, or in Spanish, Acción Extraordinaria de Protección, was then filed to the Constitutional Court because there was no evidence regarding the alleged paralyzation of public services. And because originally the public prosecutor under other legal theory and the trial brought the case was based on the alleged sabotage, the Constitutional Court dismissed without any hearing such action. Then I will explain and I will tell all the sentences against Francisco Endara. It's obvious that was violated that due process. It's obvious. Francisco Endara never was in the set of the channel. In the process, the prosecutor didn't make an identification of the accused. This means that the witness did not see in person to Francisco Endara inside of the channel. Francisco Endara didn't destroy anything, any radio. He don't do anything, must to be quiet and calm in that moment. It's important to indicate that the market penal type contemplated in the Article 158 of the Criminal Code never adapt to the conduct of Francisco Endara. Thus, guiding verbs are destroying, damaging, disabling, disrupting, and paralyzed. Because his conduct never adapted under these actions, that I have already said, Francisco and Dara didn't damage the iron door outside the state channel, break the glass door, break the windows. There was no destruction. Wires deterioration, breaking the glass. Francisco and Dara never attacked anyone. Francisco and Dara never shout either in favor or against the government. Not even the channel. He was only asking for freedom of expression. The only thing that Francisco and Dara, according to the prosecutor, the private prosecutor, and the judicial police, is to have an applaud. Situation that wasn't demonstrated in the trial, as hundreds of people who were outside of the channel asking for freedom of expression. Furthermore, is the only crime was the applause of Francisco and Dara? The question is whether such applause deserves 18 months of imprisonment and to indemnify for damages caused by such applause is a good question. What the judicial system did was to take a role to confiscate fundamental rights of a citizen on violation of the American Convention on Human Rights. In conclusion, the case of Francisco and Dara clearly shows the abuse of the judicial system by the government to prosecute opponents or critics of the government, and therefore a violation of the rule of the American Convention on Human Rights. Francisco and Dara have been developing in academic circles an opinion before 30 years. Critical views regarding the handling of human rights, the economic and the political in Ecuador. Is that a crime? Is that a crime? I don't think so. This type of process was used as an excuse for the government to pursue the people that was against the government ideas, using the judicial route. This is evident in the analyzed case, since it's clear from the beginning of the process how creative and how forcibly abuse of legal figures to prosecute Francisco and Dara. Rather, it's observed that a dispossession and disrespect for fundamental rights of a person by the simple fact of having present outside of the place, in this case, the public channel, Ecuador TV, where people were claiming for freedom of expression. This indicates that the state violated fundamental rights for the citizens, which is unthinkable in a society that claims to respect the rights of the people and the democracy. Thank you.
Do you have any questions?
Yo veo que está aquí el señor Andrada. Creo que todos tenemos la simpatía por la violación de sus derechos y el sufrimiento. Mi pregunta es si se ejecutó la pena de 18 meses de prisión y la multa.
Me voy a permitir contestar en español. Francisco Endara fue condenado a 18 meses. Muchas personas que fueron procesadas están en este momento en la cárcel y se está tratando de, obviamente, a través de la liquidación correspondiente, de cobrar esa multa. Pero en este momento, como ustedes se darán cuenta, Francisco Endara se encuentra aquí. Consideramos que puede calificarse como un perseguido político. Y Realizaremos todas las acciones a nivel internacional para que todos sus daños sean reparados.
Gracias.
Cualquier otra pregunta, pero queremos, por supuesto, todos solidarizarnos con el señor Andara y esperamos que las instancias internacionales permitan corregir esta monstruosidad de juicio que le han hecho pues, simplemente aplaudir. Creo que no hay nadie en el mundo ahí ha tenido sentencia por aplaudir. Bueno, entonces continuamos con nuestra presentación. Ahora tenemos la presentación de persecución, Persecution Without Discrimination. Y después tendremos los closing remarks, que son, que I understand that it is going to be Juan Antonio and Congresswoman Liliana Rose-Lettman. So, without much other ado, I would invite Sebastián González to please come to the podium and present the case of persecution without discrimination.
Thank you very much for having me today. It's a pleasure to be here amongst such distinguished colleagues. I will begin by saying that the case that I've analyzed in my paper is one, as we can see, that is reminiscent of many other cases in Ecuador throughout its history. Sadly, it has also been the case in other governments, not only in this one, and it has also been a recurring situation in other Latin American countries as well. As a background to this situation, we can see that the Ecuadorian government has had a very highly confrontational relationship with civil society in general, and in particular with civil society institutions. And there are several elements that have developed through this confrontational relationship. One in particular that is linked, directly linked to the case that I have analyzed is the use of military and police to dissuade public demonstrations and protests. In the specific case and in general, there has been an excessive and disproportionate use of force by these state agents. And it may surprise you to hear that the military has participated in these in the prevention of these protests. But the government has justified their participation. It has said that it is necessary, and even it has even led to an amendment to the Constitution last year, which now mandates the military for internal security. Another important element of this relationship between the government and civil society has been the use of the criminal justice system as a deterrent, as we can see, as we have heard throughout the speeches this morning. The criminal justice system has been used by the government to deter public protests, criticisms in general, in all aspects, even in social media. In this case in particular, the Saraguro community, which you may have heard of before, since it has been part of several cases, not only in the internal justice system in Ecuador, but also in the Inter-American Commission and in the Inter-American Courts, participated in a nationwide call to protest in August 2015. This community, located in the south of Ecuador in the province of Loja, came out peacefully to protest amongst several issues, particularly cultural and environmental issues. And during this protest, as I had mentioned already, the military and the police were called out to stop, to prevent the protest from occurring. And they used batons, they used tear gas, they chased and cornered the people who were protesting, and even went into their private property. 31 members of the Saraguro community were detained, and they were charged by the prosecution. And the judge accepted a request by the prosecution for private detention, for pretrial detention. And the other thing that may surprise you is the crime for which they were charged with. It is one that has already been mentioned this morning. It is the crime of stoppage of a public service. And in Ecuador, it has been common to consider that blocking a public road, a highway, for instance, in this case, the Pan American Highway, is considered a crime that is to be sanctioned between 1 to 3 years of imprisonment. And so here we have yet again the conflict between several constitutional rights and criminal law. And as we have seen in this case, as in others that have been presented this morning, there has been a situation where the constitutional rights have been subjugated to criminal law. How can the constitutional rights of assembly, resistance, and to demonstrate in public, the right to demonstrate in public, be exercised if the citizens are not allowed to be in public, be it in a road, for instance? I don't think it would be able to be exercised in somebody's backyard. It has to be in public. So these constitutional rights have been, by the judges, by the tribunals, by the courts, been subjugated to other more important criminal punishments. And another element of the case that is very important and that is also reminiscent of other cases is the use of preventive detention. As one knows in international law, as in Ecuador, it is a measure that is to be used exceptionally, and it should not be provided by the judges so easily. There are certain requirements that must be met, and in this case, obviously, this did not occur. All those that were detained lived in the same community. They worked very close, and obviously, they were not a flight risk. The government participated very actively in the case. They presented a complaint against the 31 detained, and therefore they initiated a private prosecution during the case. They requested witnesses, they presented written arguments, and they designated three attorneys to the case. Obviously disproportionate to the situation as well. The state attorney and the province governor, which is the representative of the executive in the provinces, participated also. They were called to the hearings by the judicial authorities, and obviously it demonstrates that the government wanted to be kept informed of the case. They wanted to actively participate during the proceedings. And obviously, given this interest by the government in this case, there were procedural irregularities. For instance, one that is most important is that the local prosecutor had absolved it, decided not to charge most of the 31 detained, and this, in a matter of a few hours, was revoked by the superior prosecutor, the provincial prosecutor, and he decided to reinstate charges and revoked the decision not to charge many of those that were detained. There is then a logical conclusion that there was a certain compliance by the by the prosecution and by the judicial authorities to provide favorable decisions for the government. They knew that they were watching, they knew that they were listening. And obviously, you might think that even though in the end, in my paper, I conclude that many of the detained were not sanctioned in the end, there is a possibility of appeal. But as we have mentioned this morning, there is the situation in which those that have been detained may have already been sanctioned on their own. They have passed through a very torturous procedure. They have been detained preventively. There is a situation of social criticism, and obviously their reputation in some way has been tarnished, even though they may not in the end be sentenced by a judge. So in conclusion, we can have several ideas. The first is that the government has been intent on impeding protests. There has been an abuse of the judicial system, specifically of criminal prosecution, and obviously this is inadequate. A constitutional state that Ecuador wishes to be, that it means to be, needs separation of power, legal security, and the respect for the authority of the judicial system. And as a main conclusion, we can say that Ecuador should abandon the practice of using malicious criminal proceedings for political purposes and embrace the principles of a modern democracy. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions?
Congratulations on an excellent presentation and also on your excellent English.
Thank you.
My question is, I had the impression from the report I read that that at least two individuals were sentenced to 4 years, but you said that the maximum punishment for the crime of paralyzing public services is 1 to 3 years. If the maximum is 3, how could they be sentenced to 4?
I think there might have been a case of aggravations in the sentence that extend the sanction further from what is established in the penal code. The had absolved, it decided not to charge most of the 31 detained, and this, in a matter of a few hours, was revoked by the superior prosecutor, the provincial prosecutor. And he decided to reinstate that reinstate charges, and revoked the decision not to charge many of those that were detained. There is then a logical conclusion that there was a certain compliance by the prosecution and by the judicial authorities to provide favorable decisions for the government. They knew that they were watching, they knew that they were listening. And obviously, you might think that even though in the end, in my paper, I conclude that many of the detained were not sanctioned in the end, there is a possibility of appeal. But as we have mentioned this morning, there is the situation in which those that have been detained may have already been sanctioned on their own. They have passed through a very torturous procedure. They have been detained preventively. There is a situation of social criticism, and obviously their reputation in some way has been tarnished, even though they may not in the end be sentenced by a judge. So in conclusion, we can have several ideas. The first is that the government has been intent on impeding protests. There has been an abuse of the judicial system, specifically of criminal prosecution, and obviously this is inadequate. A constitutional state that Ecuador wishes to be, that it means to be, needs separation of power, legal security and the respect for the authority of the judicial system. And as a main conclusion, we can say that Ecuador should abandon the practice of using malicious criminal proceedings for political purposes and embrace the principles of a modern democracy. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions? Professor Cassel?
Well, congratulations on an excellent presentation and also on your excellent English.
Thank you.
My question is, I had the impression from the report I read that the that at least two individuals were sentenced to 4 years, but you said that the maximum punishment for the crime of paralyzing public services is 1 to 3 years. If the maximum is 3, how could they be sentenced to 4?
I think there might have been a case of aggravations in the sentence that extend the sanction further from what is established in the penal code.
A special and heartfelt thanks to James Clever. Please raise, he has been the created a discipline for all of us who were overseeing the result with such a in such a joyful manner that you don't think that you're being disciplined. So thank you so much. Without you, it would have been impossible to undertake this project. So now we are moving to the closing remarks by Dr. Cassel and Dr. Antonio Manu. I would like to ask them, before I give them the floor, to emphasize what are the takeaways that the participants in this event should take. We all know that there are governments in Latin America that are using the judiciary in order to persecute opponents and in order to establish an authoritarianism. But this is not new. It started with Philip II very many centuries ago. And it will continue to do so unless the Latin American civil society rebuilds the institutional framework that we have. And this is a task that will take several generations because it has to be done from bottom up, not top down. And it's only, I remember François Mitterrand, that in one conversation that we had, he said, the only good law is the law that citizens carry in their heart. Once our citizens know what their rights are and what democracy is all about, and they really believe in it, then we will be able to have respect for human rights and we will have democracy in Latin America. But I would like to know what the takeaways, what Dr. Blanco and Dr. Cassel think the takeaways of this particular endeavor that we have undertaken with the collaboration of the Inter-American Bar Association. And that it, as I mentioned, is the first of several projects that we're going to undertake throughout Latin America. I think the next one on the pipeline is Venezuela, then comes Bolivia, Argentina, and the rest of the countries. It's because it is very important that at this time of transition, we expose what is going on in one of these countries so that the bad example doesn't permeate the other countries. Thank you so much for your presence. Thank you so much for your support. I congratulate all the researchers. You have done an incredibly great job. And I think that now the international community knows very well what the roads to subvert the judiciary in order to use it as a repressive instrument are in Latin America. But I'll give the floor to Dr. Blanco and then to Dr. Cassel.
Thank you. I think I'm running out of caffeine this time. Sorry. I just want to make a couple of remarks. One remark is somebody that I think was you was raised by some of the participants. And that is, when is the right moment to look at a government as a regime that has been imposed through a quiet, silent, progressive coup d'etat?
I mean, are we going to apply the charter, the democratic charter of the OAS, only when we see a bunch of tanks in the middle of the street shooting down students? Or when we see, we don't see the tanks, but we see one party that is imposing its power over all branches of society, and you go back into a situation in which you may have elections that are fraudulent, that can be controlled by the power, by the political party in power, and that starts a cycle of authoritarianism or even totalitarianism. Some people look at the situation in Venezuela today, they even see the tanks in the streets, and they still claim that that is a democracy, that that is not still the time for applying the democratic charter of the OAS to that regime. So when hearing some of the cases, like my friend here that had been sent to prison because he decided to applaud, it reminds me of North Korea. You know, in North Korea, you can be sent to a camp for not applauding, right? So this is the Korea's version of North Korea in Ecuador. You know, you can also be sent to prison if you don't know that you should not be applauding certain people. As a Cuban, one thing that I felt very clearly was in the indefensiveness. The total sense of indefensiveness that a citizen has in relation to the state. Some people say, well, human rights violations occur everywhere, and I can agree with that. You know, I have seen in Western countries cops that have been clubbing, you know, demonstrators in the streets, or have been spraying pepper spray in the faces of demonstrators. The difference is that that will be on the front page of the papers next day. The difference is that those people that have been under this kind of violations of their human rights can go to a court and establish a process against the police. The difference is that that will go to an independent court that would impose maybe a millionaire fee to the city. It happened in New York City with the Wall Street demonstrations, or the police. That's the difference. You have places to go. You can go to the media. You can go to a court. You can go to another politician and present your case. You can have an independent lawyer that would take you up. The problem with these regimes is that you don't have any of that. You have, like, everything is in place. You have courts. You have the police, you have the politicians, you have everything. It looks the same, but it doesn't work the same way. They're not independent. They're not independent from each other, and they're controlled by the state. So basically, as a Cuban, you take it, that's my feeling. My heart is with you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I apologize for coming on the floor waiting to speak. Un placer. Muchísimas gracias. Thank you so much. I'll get right over here. Thank you. You're so sweet.
Very well recognized
to that. We also urged USAID and Eddie Acevedo, our staff director, and I just met with the U.S. AID director of this area, of this hemisphere, on this very issue. We urge USAID and the Department of State to assist the media in closed societies to promote an open and free press. We're used to an open and free press. Look at our presidential elections, what's happening now, the things that they say about X candidate and what they say about Y candidate, and we take that for granted. But in some of the countries throughout the world, as we know, that's not the case. The government wants to control and restrict everything. Now, this resolution passed the House with an overwhelming vote, 399 in favor and 2 against. I cannot imagine what happened in the minds of those individuals who thought, Yes, we're not going to advocate for a free press in Latin America. Surely this can't be the reason. Let's hope that they were mad about something else and not the issue at hand. But what's been happening in Ecuador? We have seen Rafael Correa attack and even sue press outlets and journalists who publish stories that are critical of his regime. Journalists have to think twice about what they write, what they cover, what they want to publish, if they're able to publish it, because their chief executive, the president of that country, is actually suing press outlets, suing journalists who dare to question his actions. So it's important to note that the international community does notice these atrocities. They are atrocities, because these crimes don't have to be physical altercations for us to label them as atrocities. They're outrageous. These acts by the governments are outrageous acts against freedom. And we must condemn them as they occur. If you let one go because you think, oh, I've been too critical, let me let this one go, that is a signal to the oppressor that that's something that they can get away with. You can't let anything go. Nobody gets a free pass. Every egregious violation against freedom of the press has to be called out. Now, what about international organizations? How do they look at the press freedoms in Ecuador? Well, Freedom House, a highly respected institution, has rated Ecuador as, quote, not free, end quote. That's their category, not free, for a third consecutive year. Can you imagine that your country is rated in this manner? Should it worry the chief executive? Of course. But that's the way that he can control the population. The Ecuadorian NGO Fundamedios reported in 2015 that Ecuador experienced 368 aggressions on journalists. Aggressions on journalists, 368. Now, how many days in the year? So this is one act per day and more. A 44% increase from the previous year. Is the situation getting better in Ecuador, or is it getting worse? These are fundamental numbers that easily tell that story. The State Department 2015 Human Rights Report, what did they have to say? So this is now the third organization that I'm citing as saying how they describe Ecuador. Our own State Department said, the Ecuadorian regime uses libel laws against media companies, against journalists, against private individuals. So here is the full weight of the government smashing down a company that's in charge of journalism, a newspaper, a TV station, a journalist. Even private individuals are not immune. Also, the State Department Human Rights Report said that while the Constitution provides for an independent judiciary, outside pressure and corruption impaired the judicial process. In many of these countries, you would find a constitution that reads lovely. Oh my goodness, look at all of these freedoms that exist. The more lovely the Constitution, the more you should worry most of the time. So the Constitution says an independent judiciary, the reality, pressure, and corruption are demolishing the judicial system. And unless you, if you don't have a free press, and if you don't have an independent judiciary, what recourse does the person or the journalist have? And the corruption, this is from our own State Department, the corruption exists in the legislative and judicial branches. So you have an executive branch that is overusing its powers to silence and intimidate its critics. You have a legislative branch that is corrupt, and you have a judicial branch that our own State Department says is riddled with corruption. Those are the three branches of government: executive, judicial, and legislative. What hope, what resource, what recourse are available to journalists and human rights activists? Even the Committee to Protect Journalists, another respected organization, has listed Ecuador as a country of concern. And in its report, the Committee to Protect Journalists said, and I quote, "Ecuador has one of the worst press freedom records in Latin America." There's a lot of competition for being the worst. Ecuador is right up there. It's Olympian in its spirit of competition, with journalists subject to legal measures, to defamation suits, and public insults. It is very hard for a journalist to put up a story critical of the regime when you have this working against you, when you could be sued. Who has the financial wherewithal to fight a lawsuit? Who can say when your neighbors hear that you are a corrupt journalist? Because you will you won't be attacked for being a journalist. They will say que eres un ladrón, un estafador, un traficante, una persona que está lavando dinero. They will have trumped up charges against you. These defamation suits are aimed to silence you, to ruin your character and your integrity, and to silence you. And even public insults. Oh my goodness, it's like wearing a scarlet letter. Remember in the bad old days. And that's what they're doing to journalists. And the Committee to Protect Journalists also said that authorities' attempts to amend the Constitution to categorize communications as a public service is another attempt to censor news and control information. So now they're saying that this is a public service to communicate. And if you're not doing the right thing, well, then you're doing the community a disservice, as if they control the airwaves and the newsprint and every organization and dissemination of information that should belong to every man and woman. So it's important for all of us to work together to shine a spotlight of the atrocities that are being committed in Ecuador, because many other countries are using Korea's playbook. We've seen these terrible actions. The number one, you know what comes to your mind, Venezuela. We're seeing Electoral Council abusing their power to avoid a recall referendum. Maduro is desperate. What can he do to get away from this referendum? So he uses this Electoral Council, he uses the judicial system to continue to bring up trumped up charges against Venezuelan opposition leaders and even US citizens. He has booted out Miami Herald journalists from Venezuela to try to control what reporters are reporting on. And you know, if you want your beat in Venezuela and if you want your office in Caracas, the word goes out, don't cover this referendum. Don't cover the September 1st march, because you will lose your media credentials. What about Nicaragua? The same thing is happening. Ortega misuses the judicial system and the Electoral Council to help silence the opposition, to intimidate the opposition. And of course, the worst violator of all, sadly, my native homeland of Cuba. The Castro tyrannical regime does not allow an independent press, an independent judiciary. None of those are existent on the island, not since Castro took over illegally in 59. And its repression against the Cuban citizens on the island have only escalated after Obama's concession in 2014. And that's the irony of it. As the United States extended its hand, we did not wait for Castro to unclench his fist. So the fist is still clenched, and that's why you have a brave human rights activist like Coco Fariñas, who had been on a hunger strike for over 50 days to call attention to what is going on. That's why you have the ladies, Las Damas de Blanco, beaten up every Sunday for calling attention to the plight of political prisoners. But the press wants to cover the cool cars. Kim Kardashian is in Cuba. Isn't this cool? Well, Madonna just came back from Cuba. Isn't that cool? Look at these funky cars. This is very cool. And the suffering of the Cuban people gets ignored. So we've got to recognize that the abuse of the judicial system is being used by ALBA countries, those that I've named, as a tool to silence the opposition. So we must call them out on it. We've got to condemn these actions because the free and impartial judicial system is the basis of a free and open society. And I'm confident that with forums such as this one, in which we publicly denounce such abusive tactics, we will make progress in educating Congress on the realities going on within Latin America. So I thank the organizations that put this together. I thank the Inter-American Institute for Democracy. I thank the Inter-American Bar Association. Y más que nada, le doy las gracias a mi amigo Carlos. Un placer y un honor estar con ustedes. Este tema es de mucha importancia. Cuente conmigo y después de este foro, si quieren un café cubano para con estos bocaditos, pasen por este mismo piso, 2206, el mejor café cubano de Washington. No lo puedo decir en Miami, pero en Washington no hay competencia. Bueno, muchísimas gracias. Muy agradecida. Gracias.